Tonight, the season-long feast of college football on ESPN begins on a beautiful night in Raleigh, North Carolina. The ACC's best quarterback, Russell Wilson, leads NC State in a battle tonight against the head ball coach, Steve Spurrier, about to begin his fifth season as head coach at South Carolina. For the Gamecocks, the Wolfpack, and college football fans everywhere, this is our moment.
It's time to blow it up, time to lock and load, time to take the field, time to start the show. This is our moment, this is our time, and we ain't holding back, we're laying it all on the line. This is our destiny, it's our
And at long last, the moment has arrived. Welcome, everyone, to ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Applebee's. Tonight, at sold-out Carter-Finley Stadium, it's South Carolina and NC State in a rivalry that dates back to 1900. And on opening weekend of the college football season, it is Respect Weekend, the American Football Coaches Association and the NCAA encouraging the teams to shake hands before the opening kickoff. Hi, everybody. Sean McDonough, along with Craig James and Jesse Palmer, will be joined momentarily by Aaron Andrews. Delighted to have you with us as this college football season gets underway. Much anticipated all around the country, particularly here in Raleigh, North Carolina. Year three under head coach Tom O'Brien. You see the steady improvement. They think this could be the breakthrough year.
And they spent those first two seasons trying to get everybody to buy in, right? You know, he kept talking to the players about his plan, and that he's been there, he's done that. And the players said, yeah, we really believe in you, coach. Last year, we had this ball club and they played South Carolina and they said they thought they could win. This year they expect to win. At some point in Coach O'Brien's tenure, there's going to be a game, and it could be tonight, the game that really gets them over the hump to really believing that next level game. And as Coach O'Brien said, it's time for us now to start winning ACC titles, competing for that title. Tonight's a first step.
And when Steve Spurrier arrived at South Carolina, that was the expectation, that he and the Gamecocks would contend for an SEC title. They've had a good 4 years. Your old coach describes it as just a little bit better than mediocre.
No other coach in South Carolina history has won as many games as Steve Spurrier in his first 4 years. Having said that, they haven't been very competitive when it comes to attaining an SEC title. Now, after losing their last three games last year in a blowout loss to Iowa in the Outback Bowl, Steve Spurrier said he had never been so frustrated in his career. They did a great job recruiting this past offseason. He brought in six new coaches to his staff, and because of that, he said he's more energized. The players have never seen him more enthusiastic, and we're going to see a new wrinkle on offense for South Carolina. They say they're going to stay committed to running the football. The players are ready. The coaches are ready. Guys, the 2009 regular season is finally here.
Hey, can we shake hands up here in the booth?
Yes.
Friendly night.
Friendly
gesture.
Night, guys. Friendly night.
Have a good ball game.
I'll work toward the respect for you two as we go on Respect Weekend. The crowd is certainly ready. As Tom O'Brien said, Wolfpack Nation energized with the anticipation of this season. 20 seniors on the NC State team, a great quarterback. Everything seems to be in place for an excellent year, including an excellent kicker. Josh Jakowski will kick off for NC State. The Pack won the toss and deferred. Chris Culliver, a dangerous deep man, back deep for the Gamecocks. And the season is underway as Jakowski sends it down to the five. Culliver brought it back to the 27, tackled by Earl Wolf, and we welcome in Aaron Andrews.
John, thanks so much. Sophomore quarterback Steven Garcia started a few times last year, made several appearances for the Gamecocks, but tonight, the first time in his career and for a game, he comes in as the number one guy. Well, the head ball coach, Steve Spurrier, I'll quote him for you. He said, well, we're going to live with Steven Garcia. He's the best we have so far. Guys, the key for Garcia, according to the coaches, make good decisions. Take care of the ball. And Steve Spurrier says, I won't pull you out quickly. Jesse, I'll leave you to decide if that's true.
They want to establish the run. They go to the run on first down with very little, a yard, and that is all for Brian Maddox. The junior from Anderson, South Carolina. And we take a look at impact players for the Gamecocks.
Well, with Kenny McKinley gone, Mo Brown steps up into that flanker role. He's the returning leader in terms of receiving yards last year. He's going to have to make some big plays tonight.
It could be running back by committee, but this young man, Jarvis Giles, in the spring game, 12 carries, 114 yards, explosive.
And when they're on defense, the leader is Eric Norwood, two times first team All-SEC at linebacker. Gain of one for Maddox. Garcia out of the gun. They give it to Maddox again, and a much better run. He's 2 yards short of a first down. After a gain of seven, South Carolina was the worst rushing team in the SEC last year, only 94 yards per game on the ground.
You know, when you talk about themes for a football team, the offensive line, Jesse, South Carolina's tried for a couple of years to run the ball. They just can't get it going up front.
And they brought in Eric Wolford, a new offensive line coach who was at Illinois before. He's brought in. He's going to be the run game coordinator all season long.
Third down and two. Garcia out of the gun with a long count. Quick throw to the near side. Caught by Torrey Gurley, and he appears to have the first down. He does, with a spot at the 40-yard line. A gain of four, knocked out by Rashard Smith, a true freshman who they think has a very bright future. He's going to start the year as their nickelback on defense for NC State. So a solid start for Steven Garcia, who had a horrific performance in their bowl loss to Iowa in the Outback Bowl. He turned the ball over four times in the first half and was yanked. Play action pass to Patrick DeMarco. And he gets five. C.J. Wilson chopped him down for North Carolina State.
I like the play calling right now from South Carolina. They're allowing their quarterback, Steven Garcia, to get into a rhythm. He's not having to force the football downfield too much. Give him a couple quick completions, allow him to feel comfortable.
And he's making the defense look from side to side. You know, he's used both sides of the field so far, so that defense's eyes are wandering.
Six touchdowns, eight interceptions last year. South Carolina quarterbacks threw 27 interceptions last year, most in the country. Might be changing the play on second and five, and there's a fumble, and Garcia's on it. Maddox got rocked behind the line of scrimmage by Audie Cole. And the Gamecocks recover, but it's a loss back to the 37.
Well, this Audie Cole, 42, is a guy that's got a black belt degree, and he's one of those players that they're really excited about and talking about how he avoids the block and explodes into the ball carrier.
Patrick DeMarco was a little bit late fitting on Audie Cole. Audie Cole, an outstanding athlete, showing you the speed to be able to get in the backfield and force a fumble.
Loss of seven, third down and 12. Inside handoff to Maddox, a yard and a half, and that's all. So one first down on the opening possession for South Carolina, and here comes a punt.
You get the feeling in this football game, South Carolina playing on the road is going to have to do a very good job managing their down and distances. They cannot afford to get into third and long too often.
How about the fact that NC State's defense shows up opening series? There's that expecting to win mentality they were talking about.
T.J. Graham has national caliber track speed, back for the punt from Spencer Lanning, who averaged 42 per punt last year, and this is a boomer. Graham fielded it at the six and is taken down at the 16-yard line by Chris Culliver. 55-yard punt. That's longer than any punt Lanning had last year. And here's Russell Wilson, the sophomore out of Richmond, Virginia, two-sport athlete. Divides his time in the spring between the spring practices with the football program and the Wolfpack baseball team, where he is a second baseman, drafted out of high school by the Baltimore Orioles in the 41st round, but wanted to go to college at a place he could play both sports, and he's had that chance here in Raleigh. From the 17, and there's a fumble, knocked loose behind the line of scrimmage. Tony Baker stripped by Devin Taylor, and the Gamecocks have recovered at the 14-yard line. That's the first carry in 2 years for Tony Baker, who's been out for two seasons recovering from two knee surgeries. He's waited 2 years for this moment, and not the way he envisioned.
Tony Baker told us he was excited to find out when the adrenaline hit him how he'd respond. This is not the start he wanted. Stripped, bad job, ball security, and now a sudden change opportunity for South Carolina.
Arian Stewart recovered. On first down, the carry goes to the 7-yard line. Brian Maddox tackled by the middle linebacker Ray Michelle.
You know, Tony Baker, you know, this young man, everybody in the stadium was pulling for him a couple of years being away from the game. But that's what happens when you've been away. He had the ball in the wrong hand. He had it in the left, and he's trying to go to the right. Guy reaches in, slaps the ball out. Now his defense has to come out and bail him out of the problems.
Second and three from just inside the 8. Mike Archer, the defensive coordinator, said they'd move around a lot, try to confuse Garcia. It looks like he's checked a couple of times. Good check there. He handed it off to Maddox, who has a first down with a power run down to the 3.
Steve Spurrier told us he wanted to see his offensive line be nastier this year, really fire off the ball. These last two snaps we've seen, that offensive line of South Carolina is just driving NC State's front back.
South Carolina shut out NC State last year in the opener. Turnovers were a big key in that game. The turnover set up this possession, and it's down to the goal line. Brian Maddox again.
The one thing missing last year in our conversations with Steve Spurrier about his running game was not talking about how he wanted them to be mean. He's saying that now, and I think that's good. Openly, get out there and talk about it. I want you mean, nasty. We're going to have a different attitude, which they really worked on during the spring.
They have 3 returning starters on the offensive line. They have a touchdown from Brian Maddox. Turnover leads to 6 points. Spencer Lanning adds the extra point. Brian Maddox with all 4 carries. They ran 4 plays after recovering the fumble. All of them Maddox runs. The turnover by Baker set it up. 7-0 South Carolina. Well, the new line coach Eric Wolford has to be happy with the performance of his bunch. They've played power football in their first 2 possessions and lead 7-0. It's a season-long feast of college football. We have more than just an appetizer here tonight. When we're done, we'll send you to Boise for the much-anticipated game between Oregon and Boise State. A lot of people believe, fellas, if Boise State wins that one, they're on their way to an undefeated season and probably a BCS bowl game.
BCS Buster Talk will start tonight. If Boise State's able to get that win, they've already proven they can run the table in the regular season. They did it last year.
Adam Yates kicks off for South Carolina. And it comes down to T.J. Graham. And he's out to the 25-yard line. Tackled by Alonzo Winfield. It was a tough outing on offense a year ago in Columbia for NC State when they were shut out 34-0. The Wolfpack had just 138 yards of offense in that game. They play without Tony Baker, who after 1 carry for the first time in 2 years and a fumble is not on the field to begin this possession.
That's not the way that he's gone through rehab mentally. The play, his first play in his mind through all of that rehab was a lot different than what he got.
Jamel Eugene is in at running back.
And he takes the inside handoff from Russell Wilson and goes to the 28-yard line. And let's take a look at the impact players tonight for North Carolina State.
Well, we had a chance to see Willie Young on defense early. He's the best player on that side of the ball. You're going to see him lined up all over the field as he's trying to get pressure on Steven Garcia.
Well, Ted Larson was on that side of the ball. Last year, Tom O'Brien brought him over, put him at center. Now he's one of the country's best.
And Tony Baker, their leading rusher in 2006 as a sophomore, injured in the first quarter of the first game in 07 against Central Florida, playing for the first time since then tonight. Quick throw and catch, and down short of a first down is Jarvis Williams, and an excellent tackle by Akeem Augusti, who prevented the first down by stopping the receiver just where he caught the ball.
We talked to Ellis Johnson, who's going to be calling plays on defense for South Carolina. He is very concerned because of the youth and the lack of depth on his side of the football this year. Remember last year, this is one of the best units in the entire country. A lot of guys have moved on to the National Football League. How will they respond here in a tough environment on the road?
Third down and one for Russell Wilson. And what a tackle. Jamel Eugene was driven back, and it appears he was short of the first down. The defense led by Travion Robertson. And that is a depleted defensive front. They gave him a great spot, though, and it's going to be a first down. Well, the Gamecock fans were here, and they sold all of their 4,300 tickets, booing that spot. And Steve Spurrier looking up at a replay board to wonder about that spot.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, that was a very favorable spot right there. But you know what? NC State's offensive line has to show up. They've got to get a little push up front.
Play action fake by Wilson, an elusive runner, and his throw's a little bit too high. Thrown over the head of Steven Howard.
Russell Wilson was such a great story last year. He won a five-man battle to win the starting quarterback job, and all he did as a true freshman was throw 17 touchdowns versus one interception on his way to becoming the first ever ACC quarterback, true freshman, to be named first-team All-ACC.
But how about Dana Bible, the offensive coordinator, dialing up a call right there to get Adam on the corner, and Wilson's got the arm, but he's got to settle down, which has been a problem of his in the past.
249 passes without an interception for Wilson. Hands it off again to Jamel Eugene. He's out to the 41-yard line. That streak is intact. It's the longest active streak beginning this college football season. It's already the NC State record for most attempts in a row without an interception. 17 touchdown passes last year with just that one pick.
And a guy that plays spring baseball. You know, you'd think if he stayed around football a little bit more, he'd be even better.
It's only 5'11", listed at 201 pounds. Third down and four, man wide open. First down, another big hit delivered. It was Augusti again delivering the blow, but Darrell Davis held on. Gain of six and a first down for the Wolfpack.
I think one of the advantages NC State has is they have great size at wide receiver, and this is a zone, and Darrell Davis should sit that down and save the big hit. You're seeing a little bit of inexperience here running through the zone, and that's exactly what will happen if you don't identify the coverage.
Well, he used to be a basketball player. You know, he's got to learn to settle down in that zone. He won't take that rib shot.
He was on the basketball team here at NC State when Tom O'Brien's staff first arrived. Good move behind the line of scrimmage, and it turns into a quality run. Rodney Polk made the tackle on Jamel Eugene, who split time last year as the featured runner with Andre Brown, who was drafted into the National Football League.
Julian Williams, you see Big 73 pulling around that time, you know, putting a focus on this offensive line. If they're going to beat an SEC team, Jesse, they got to get it done up front.
They have a veteran offensive line, three fifth-year seniors and a junior. Second and five. Wilson hit as he throws. It's a deep ball. They're looking for a flag, and they're not going to get it. Owen Spencer was the intended receiver. And once again, Akeem had the coverage. He's been a busy man.
They're going to take their shots with Owen Spencer. He set an ACC record last year, averaging 22.3 yards a catch. He is their best deep threat, had five catches over 44 yards last year. He gets a separation. You see a little bit of a tug grabbing the arm. I don't know. I think that might have been altering the course of the wide receiver.
If you're a Wolfpack, that's holding.
If you're a quarterback, that's holding.
Yeah, absolutely. I think he grabbed his arm.
Third down and five at the South Carolina 48. Wilson running out of time. Just back to the line of scrimmage, and that's it. There's Eric Norwood. Back for his senior year. He thought a long time last year at the end of the bowl game about going into the NFL draft. He decided to come back, finish his degree, and try to take this program once again to the next level.
Russell Wilson's clock is going to have to go fast today. He's going to have to get through 1, 2, 3 in his progressions, tuck it and run. The speed of these SEC defenses is going to show itself. You just saw it right there from Eric Norwood.
Jeff Ruiz from Chula Vista, California, home of the Little League World Series champs. First year at NC State, and his punt is deflected, and it is free behind the line of scrimmage. Blocked by Devin Taylor. And it'll be South Carolina ball at the 38-yard line. That's the second big play of the night by Taylor. He forced the fumble that led to the opening score. And now he blocks the first punt of his collegiate career for Jeff Ruiz.
We didn't have a clock on this here in the booth, but it just seemed like the play took a long time. The snap and getting the ball off was not timely, and pressure came right up the middle.
It's a great start for Shane Beamer's unit. He's the new special teams coach of South Carolina. Great pressure up front, just more physical at the point of attack. It looked right there like NC State didn't even want to block them. And you see number 7, he looked like he got late setting the wedge.
Here's Shane Beamer, his dad Frank, known for Beamer ball, particularly for Virginia Tech's outstanding special teams play over the years. Second start in plus field position for South Carolina. They want it all, and they have it all. Touchdown to Torrey Gurley. Flagged down. There was a lot of pushing and shoving back and forth. We'll see which way it goes. C.J. Wilson thinks Gurley pushed off.
Lots of contact in the end zone there. I would not be surprised if this thing's coming back.
Well, the players are all walking back toward the original line of scrimmage.
Pass interference, number 81, offense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Replay first down.
C.J. Wilson is a true freshman, a redshirt freshman. He had a great spring. He's a surprise player. He was on the scout team last year, and he's back in position, but he did get pushed. You know, if you get pushed from behind, not much you can do about it.
It was the slightest little shove, and Torrey Gurley, 6'5". He'd like to high point this football if he could. The ball severely underthrown. Even that little push right there in front of that line judge, he's going to call that every time.
A little push?
A little shove. They're always little in the passing. If you play offense, they're always little.
It was enough to negate a 38-yard touchdown. Torrey Gurley was Torrey Childers last year. Changed his name to honor his dad, Norris Gurley, who was killed in 2008 in a car crash. Norris was a basketball player at Virginia Tech, only 42 years old when he died. Garcia takes off running. Gets 5 and then gets wrestled down at the 48-yard line. Good tackle by Justin Byers, who got benched in the middle of last year for his poor tackling.
Well, one of the things Spurrier has said is that his offense has changed. He's added some wrinkles to it, but that the quarterback is going to have to be more mobile and make some plays with his legs.
Steve Spurrier said he wanted Steven Garcia to do a better job this year getting through his progressions before running. On that instance, everybody was covered. He had to take off, and he did a good job.
Here's their leading returning rusher from last year at 198 yards. Second and 20. Under 4 minutes to go in the first quarter. Gurley's in trouble, slips away, and turns it into a gain. That should have been a big loss. Instead, it goes down to the 44-yard line for a pickup of 4.
This is just individual effort. from the big Torrey Gurley here. Jason Barnes out front trying to get a block. He gets beat to the play by Adi Cole. And that's a receiver shedding off a 240-pound linebacker.
And Adi Cole now, 42, he's a former quarterback. So his tackling skills might not be as good now as down the road. And Justin Byers got to get over and make the play.
Well, he whiffed too. We just talked about last year they put him on the bench because of his poor tackling. Third down and 16. NC State had the worst pass defense in the ACC last year, and it is still a young and inexperienced group in the defensive backfield. Timeout, South Carolina. They're off to a great start 12 minutes into the season. Last night they were fired up and ready to go, and they're still making plenty of noise despite the bad start for the Wolfpack. Now trying to help this defense, defending a third down and 16. Garcia with plenty of time. Trying to be patient, but had nowhere to go, so takes it down and runs out of bounds, well short of the first down at the 39-yard line. That's a gain of 5.
Playing wide receiver, there are subtle nuances to help yourself get open. This is not one of them. Pushing off is pretty blatant and obvious.
Wait a minute, you said it was just a little push.
Steve Spurrier has the answer. Look, use your shoulder. Don't push off. It's too obvious.
He did, Sean. Did not Jesse say that he thought it really just a slight?
Yeah, he said it was a little push. Now he says it's way too obvious.
A little jab. Ask Larry Fitzgerald, T.O., Andre Johnson, the best in the world, will tell you. That little shoulder gets you open every time.
Spencer Lanning trying to drop it inside the 5, and they cannot rescue it. Touchback. And it'll come out to the 20 after a timeout. NC State on offense, down 7-0. Saturday night on ABC, two top 10 powerhouses, Alabama and Virginia Tech, collide in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines. That's part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week, Saturday at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. There are 4 games in this opening weekend that match 2 ranked teams, but that's the headliner among that bunch. NC State first and 10 from its own 20. Tony Baker, 2 hands on that ball after his early fumble. He gets 5. Driven out of bounds by Rodney Paul.
Like the timing of that. You know, just get back, get the ball in the hands on the outside, let your players get involved with it.
Rodney Paul was the defender.
Third possession for NC State. They've had 27 yards of offense dealing with that tough field position. And that pass is incomplete. Intended for Owen Spencer. And we check in for the first time this year with Reese Davis.
Hello, Sean. SportsCenter right now. Michael Vick playing for the Eagles at the moment against the Jets. He will be able to play for real in week 3 at home against Kansas City. That announcement coming from Commissioner Roger Goodell today. Oklahoma will be without star tight end Jermaine Gresham in the opener against BYU. He has some cartilage damage in his knee. Continue to evaluate his injury. SportsCenter on ESPN2 following U.S. Open tennis. Stay current with ESPN News.
Third down and 5 here. Thank you, Reese. Wilson throws down the field, a wide open receiver, and it's incomplete. T.J. Graham was the target. The ball hung in the air for just a second, and the true freshman, Devontae Holloman, was there to knock it away.
It appears as though there was definitely a coverage bust, and this could be the feast or famine that goes on when you play true freshman in the secondary. Give Devontae Holloman a ton of credit, though, showing you that athleticism, able to close the space, dislodge the ball from the wide receiver.
And you know what? As a receiver, try to find a way to get back there, and you know that you're going to get hit right when the ball's coming. The timing has to be on your side, not the defender's side.
Well, Jeff Ruiz with his second collegiate punt. The first one was blocked. See if that 3-man wedge in front of him does a better job of blocking. Just in case they went to the rugby-style punt. There was no rush from South Carolina. And the punt went out of bounds at the 38-yard line. ...37-yard punt. And no return as we check out the AP preseason top 10. And if it's like recent years. There'll be a number of surprises that move up into that group before the year is over.
Yeah, how about Ole Miss there at number 8? Be interesting to follow them, Jesse. I don't know.
I really like them in the SEC West. The best schedule of any team in the SEC West. They get Alabama and LSU at home. Don't have to play Florida in the regular season.
We got them on the air at South Carolina.
Absolutely.
True freshman Jarvis Giles is in at running back, a highly touted recruit. Garcia dumps it off short to his big tight end Wesley Saunders. And he's dragged down after a short gain by Shea McKean.
Yeah, you know, when you look at that AP top 25 and the teams that are out there, Notre Dame jumps in there in the top 25. You know, there's some teams. The uncertainty of a lot of clubs, I guess, is what allowed Notre Dame to jump up there.
And a very favorable schedule as well.
They open with Nevada, then have Michigan on ABC a week from Saturday. Inside handoff. It's Patrick DeMarco for the first down. And he's fighting for every inch. The one thing that is noticeable immediately, I mean, they barely showed up for the bowl game. But all the players that we talked to for South Carolina this week said we had a great camp. The offseason was about team building, playing for each other. Sometimes we hear that, you don't believe it, but it's obvious they're giving a great effort tonight.
They had 100% participation in their offseason workout program, and that's unbelievable. This team is focused on doing something positive this year and starting their own tradition.
They have dominated the first quarter. Under a minute to go now in the opening quarter. First collegiate carry for Jarvis Giles, a true freshman out of Gaither High School in Tampa, Florida. Giles arrived early, like so many do now. He was there in time for the spring semester, got acclimated academically, and also took part in spring practice along with Devontae Holloman, who just made the big play on defense, and Stephon Gilmore. So they have the head start, and they also all got better than a 3.0 in the spring semester.
Well, maybe a guy like Giles is one of those players who helps keep this team together in the second half. To answer your question about the energy, they have it tonight. They fall apart in the second half of the schedule usually.
Might be the final play of the quarter. Third time the Gamecocks have been in NC State territory, and that ball's dropped. That would have been a first down. Inside the 30, Wesley Saunders dropped it. And that is the final play of the first quarter. It was the first incomplete pass for Steven Garcia.
It's time to blow it up, time to lock and load, time to take the field, time to start the show. This is our
Saturday Night Football.
Sean McDonough, Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Aaron Andrews. It sold out Carter Finley Stadium on a perfect night for football. We head to the second quarter. South Carolina leading 7-0. They control the first quarter. On third and 5, Garcia got it off, and it's a first down. Great effort by Mo Brown, one of the senior captains elected by his teammates, who took on the responsibility of bringing this team together in the offseason. He made a big play, a gain of 6.
It's really a nice job by Steven Garcia, playing fast, putting his foot in the ground, letting the throw beat the rush.
He knew where the ball was supposed to go, so he was decisive. He gets back, plants the foot, lets the football go.
He's now 5 out of 6 passing for just 24 yards. Of course, he had a touchdown called back on an offensive pass interference. Jarvis Giles again. He got stood up, and he's in trouble. Taken down well behind the line of scrimmage by Coyle George.
A true freshman mistake by Jarvis Giles. Sometimes you have to know when the play is dead. Just push north, keep pounding. The beauty of true freshmen is they think they can get out and score like high school, Craig, but that's not always the answer when you play at this level.
He got away with that on Friday nights last year. You know, he could bounce back there, and all of a sudden it was a great run around the corner for 40 yards and a touchdown. You got to learn when your journey's over. Give it up.
His journey ended with a loss of 9. Second and 19. They're back at the 48, leading 7-0. Ryan Maddox, the ball carrier. And Alan Michael Cash made the tackle, defensive tackle. They call him the whirling dervish. Usually he eats up the blockers to let others make the tackle.
When South Carolina has kept themselves manageable tonight, they've looked pretty good. There's been a lot of possessions so far. They've had a lot of second and third and longs, whether it's penalties, poor decisions on run plays. That's going to bite them in the end. They have to keep the chains manageable.
Third down and 18. Five-man rush. Garcia in trouble and sacked. Rashard Smith, the true freshman, with a big play.
Right side of your screen, a very well-timed blitz by a true freshman. Smith coming in, making a play. Excellent call defensively.
That was another problem for South Carolina last year. They gave up more sacks than any team in the SEC. Loss of nine. Spencer Lanning on the punt to the speedy T.J. Graham. Former state champion in the 100 meters didn't have a chance to field it, and Lanning got a great bounce inside the 5-yard line. Shaq Wilson down to down it. They'll spot it inside the 5. 51-yard punt. We're back on campus, brought to you by the movie Sorority Row. And tonight's Back on Campus focuses on the Florida Gators seeking their third national title in 4 years. Many believe they have a great chance to do it. Preseason number one, led by Tim Tebow, and everybody who started on the defense back.
I'd say that's reason to believe you have a chance, right, Sean?
Yeah, it's a good starting point.
Coach, what do you think?
Good starting point.
I'll take the defense. You coach the offense. Jesse will raise the money for the university.
Then poor field position for North Carolina State. And Jamel Eugene gets a yard, and that's all. And here's Aaron.
And Sean, this NC State offensive line that struggled throughout most of the game, getting some bad news about their junior left tackle, Jake Vermiglio. He is out with a calf injury. They're going to reevaluate him at halftime and make a decision there. But I do have to tell you, this offensive line getting pretty jacked up about their defense when they came off the field. Actually saw some life out of these guys as they got ready to lead the offense on. We'll see what happens here.
That offensive line has helped pave the way for just 11 rushing yards on 7 carries. Russell Wilson with all day to throw, has his man. Owen Spencer for the biggest gain of the night for North Carolina State. There's a flag down back near the line of scrimmage. If it stands, it's a 38-yard pickup.
Receiver number 64 offense was downfield. Half the distance from the goal from the previous spot. Replay second down.
This is one of the rule changes that we talked about this offseason, something the referees were going to do a much better job of calling and emphasizing. If linemen get more than 3 yards downfield, they're going to call this every single time. Huge play for NC State, negated.
Yeah, well, with Vermiglio out, now you've got Andrew Wallace backing up at left guard. Now he goes in to left guard. The left guard, Julian Williams, was out at left tackle. So you've got some changes up there, and it'll take a while for them to set their pads.
And it's Wallace who just came into the game who got the penalty that nullified a 38-yard gain. Well, each team's had a 38-yard play negated. Well, you thought, fellas, and you were there last year in Columbia when North Carolina State was shut out 34-0 at 138 yards of offense. They couldn't be worse on offense tonight, but they are.
Longest play of either team, 7 yards. I mean, this is, I would say, inept.
I'd say NC State at this point has really struggled with its execution, whether it's drop passes, whether it's fumbles. It's been bad.
Third down and second down and 12 from their own 2, and it's a 2-yard gain for Jamel Eugene. Eric Norwood made the tackle. And last year, they anticipated they might struggle. They had a patchwork offensive line. They had five quarterback candidates. Russell Wilson emerged over the course of the season. But they have a veteran bunch now back in whom they have a lot of confidence.
Well, Dana Bible, the offensive coordinator, told us last year they weren't able to dictate to the defense. They had to shift in motion and try to get them confused. This year, the pieces are in place. They have to start dictating now to this inexperienced South Carolina defense.
Conservative play call up against their own goal line. Jamel Eugene took the inside handoff and came up 4 yards short of the first down at the 10, and they'll have to punt again.
I think, Sean, though, when you really think about it, go back to the first play of the game, NC State fumbles the ball, right? So they put them into a conservative, cautious mode that they haven't gotten out of.
South Carolina is winning the field possession battle right now. Heading into this drive, NC State's starting average field possession was on their own 17-yard line. South Carolina is going to get the ball back here at midfield again.
As you might have guessed, that agitated man talking to Tom O'Brien was Don Horton, the longtime offensive line coach, one of the very best in the country. Ruiz gets the kickoff under some pressure, and it's a good one. Akeem Augusti taken out of bounds. Very good coverage as well by Clem Johnson. 52-yard punt. That's the third punt in this game from the two punters of over 50 yards. Craig James drooling in the booth for the first time this year.
Oh, I've had three burgers down here already. Got another one coming at midnight tonight.
Neither quarterback has lit it up. Neither offense has been productive. South Carolina took advantage of a short field after a turnover. They lead 7-0. Steven Garcia under pressure. As a man open, a better throw, and there could have been some run after the catch from Mo Brown, but he had to go to the ground to haul it in. That is the longest gain of the night for either team, a pickup of 15.
I love this by Steven Garcia. In the pre-snap, he sees the Sam linebacker and the strong safety blitzing, but he knows the protection can pick it up. Brian Maggs does a nice job getting outside, allowing Garcia to step up, and then on the run makes the safe throw and completion for the first down.
They're across midfield again. Here's Patrick DeMarco. And the ball's out. And the officials rule him down by contact inside the 40-yard line. Patrick is the nephew of the outstanding PGA Tour golfer Chris DeMarco, a Florida Gator and a huge Gator fan, a good pal of Coach Spurrier.
This is one of those plays, guys, where you pull the slingshot back and you can feel it. You can feel it coming out. And now two plays in a row, you see the South Carolina offense. They got them on the ropes now.
They look really good right now, surging off the football. They weren't lying. They are committed to running the football.
Brian Maddox. Yeah, they're dashing him with the run. He goes to the 30 for a gain of 9 and a first down for South Carolina.
And the new offensive line coach, Eric Wolford, he brings a track record with him from Illinois. Back in 2007, they led the Big Ten in rushing yards. 2008, led the Big Ten in passing yards. He's bringing his run game with him. I have not seen the South Carolina offensive line come off the ball like this since Steve Spurrier has coached at this school.
He said he wanted that line to be meaner and nastier and more aggressive, and they've done that tonight. Power football again. And 9 more for Brian Maddox. Took Earl Wolf, a backup in the secondary, to make the tackle.
This is just solid football. Right guard, watch the right side of your screen over here. The pull, TJ Johnson. Find somebody, push up in there. There's body on body.
You love that inside power play because it's a statement play. You pull the backside guard, bring an extra blocker at the point of attack, and just say, look, try to stop us.
Last three plays have been runs of 7, 9, and 9. Now back to the air. Garcia flushed. And finally, he goes down for a loss of about 4. Back at the 25-yard line. He kept the play alive for a long time, but Jesse, you're squirming up here. Time to get rid of it, too.
This was a pass coverage sack, really. I mean, there was no place to go with the football for Steven Garcia. As a quarterback, though, if you're going to run, that's fine. You have to get on the ground. Playing against these type guys, you're going to get your head knocked.
Well, what you're risking when you get out there doing that is a ball getting stripped. That's what you risk.
Quick count on third and five. Maddox. Where are they going to give him the spot? He bounced ahead. There's a late flag thrown for some activity away from where the tackle was made. For now, they're signaling first down, but the referee is not aware that there was the late flag thrown.
One thing Tom O'Brien is really good about is not panicking. He's one of those guys that comes out and he knows right now his team's on the ropes and they're not doing well, but he's not going to panic, and he's going to get his team together and he's going to talk about it and remind them of the game and what they're supposed to be doing.
This is first and goal officially. Those are the football on the 10-yard line. Maddox, as they keep it on the ground. And Jesse, you've known Steve Spurrier a long time. We all have. We've heard him say numerous times over the years, we have to run the football. We need to establish the run. We need to stay with the run. A lot of times when it doesn't work, he can get a little impatient and get away with it. But when it doesn't work, you have to do something else. Now it's working for him.
It's working. And I wonder what's going on in his head right now. Here they are in the red zone. Steve Spurrier loves throwing touchdowns more than anybody I've ever been around.
Maddox again. He is collared at the line of scrimmage. Good surge by the left side of that defensive unit led by Willie Young, the ACC's active leader in career tackles for loss and sacks. And he was involved in some trash talk back and forth with the Gamecocks during the week.
But, Craig, what we've seen in this running game today, their attitude runs. There's that inside power play again.
Yeah, but the difference there is Terrence Campbell, the left guard, when he pulled to come around, NC State's defense had started to figure it out. They plugged the hole.
And a timeout has been called by North Carolina State. Defense might be tired. They admitted, Willie Young told us yesterday, we were gassed in the second half last year. That was a 10-0 game in Columbia. South Carolina led late in the third quarter last year. It wound up 34-0 when the defense, kind of like this, they were on the field all night, so sooner or later you're going to get tired.
Well, Russell Wilson, when he went down, it was over with because the offense really had nothing for them.
South Carolina's run 29 plays to only 16 for NC State. Saturday night, ESPN brings you the Dick Sporting Goods Cowboy Classic. The reigning Heisman Trophy winner Sam Bradford and Oklahoma kick off their season in the brand new Dallas Cowboys Stadium, where they'll take on BYU. It's the Dick Sporting Goods Cowboy Classic, part of Dick Sporting Goods Kickoff Week on ESPN, Saturday at 7 Eastern Time. Third down and goal, South Carolina. 5 minutes to go in the half. They lead 7-0. Steven Garcia in trouble and sacked back at the 13-yard line. Shea McKean, the senior out of Princeton, New Jersey.
It almost seemed like Garcia, when he was in the pocket, he had a pocket, Jesse, but he got nervous feet and he wouldn't stay and trust his linemen.
It was a junk look. He had Willie Young looking like he was going to rush the end. He dropped back into coverage. What I like, though, about Steven Garcia there, not forcing it stupidly, understanding that points are at a premium, allowing his team a chance for a field goal.
First career field goal attempt for Spencer Lanning, and it's a tough hold by Stephen Flint, running for his life, and he is tackled back at the 19. Clem Johnson tackled him, but Stephen Flint had trouble getting that ball on the ground for Lanning's first ever field goal attempt in a college game.
So there's the break NC State finally got in this football game. They have been flat. The snap was not that bad. You got to pick that up. You got to come through with it. But you know what, Jesse? Now what's NC State going to do with this opportunity?
Absolutely. This is the first real break they've had in this game. The game is still a one-possession contest with over 4 minutes left. This is a major drive, and Mike Glennon is now in the game.
And this was by design before the game. It's not a product of their struggles on offense so far, although it might be well timed. Maybe the redshirt freshman out of Centerville, Virginia, Glennon, can provide a spark. His brother Sean is the quarterback at Virginia Tech. And Mike Glennon is a big fella, 6'6", 211 pounds. He was very highly recruited with a big arm.
He is a player that this coaching staff raved about last year. NFL prototype, size and arm, never played a real game yet. Let's see how he responds.
Second and 8. Dumps it off in the flat. Taylor Gentry got popped right at the line of scrimmage by Darian Stewart. Can we dust off the old cliche for the first time this year? Tom O'Brien and the Wolfpack have to feel very fortunate to only be down by 7-0 right now.
Yeah, absolutely. You see a nice blow and a tackle on the outside. But Glennon, the reason he's in right now is because Tom O'Brien knows he's got a quarterback in Russell Wilson who is injury prone. Not injury prone, but he's had his issues with injuries. They have to have another quarterback prepared should Wilson go down again.
Rodney Polk is on the field injured and being helped off now for South Carolina. Well, three different times last year Russell Wilson went down with injuries, including in the opener against South Carolina when he suffered a grade 3 concussion. He told us yesterday he remembers very little about that opening game last year in Columbia.
And you got to remember, Russell Wilson also plays baseball, and he's eligible for the Major League Baseball draft again after next summer. The coaching staff here isn't sure if he's going to stick around. Again, Russell Wilson's 5'11". That's not exactly NFL prototype size for the quarterback position. He got drafted coming out of high school. He thinks he could go high. You got to prepare in the case that he's not around.
And
I think this is a great idea, getting Glenn in time now.
And Tom O'Brien did this when he was at Boston College. Would occasionally have the backup quarterback, if he was inexperienced, take a series or two in the second quarter of a game. 3 minutes to go in the half. He zings one down the hash mark. Incomplete. Showed off that strong arm there looking for T.J. Graham. But that secondary closing nicely on the ball tonight. That time it was Chris Culliver.
All right, now you see exactly what O'Brien and Dana Bible are saying about this guy. What a delivery over the top down the seam.
One thing the coach has told us is that Mike Glennon plays with conviction. When he throws it somewhere, it's 100 miles an hour, and you saw that right there. That was not a big window. Not very many guys could have made that throw, but you see the natural talent that Mike Glennon brings to the field.
There's Jeff Ruiz to punt. That one blocked, and then boom to a 50-plus yarder. This one short and wobbly. Akeem Auguste telling his teammates to get away from it, and it takes a good bounce for the Wolfpack. Gonna mark it at the 30. And it's a 49-yard punt, celebrating its fifth year sponsoring the Good Hands Field Goal Nets. Allstate makes contributions to participating universities' general scholarship funds for each field goal and extra point kicked. To date, Allstate has already contributed more than $1.8 million in scholarship monies. They are the Good Hands people, and that money goes into Good Hands. Steven Garcia with the delayed handoff to Maddox. And Brian is wrapped up by Audie Cole, the former high school quarterback who was on his way to go to Central Michigan and play quarterback. But then Brian Kelly left. He was recruited by Tom O'Brien to go to Boston College. Tom O'Brien left BC and came to NC State, and Cole wound up coming with him. Second and 6. Two timeouts left for each team. Final 2:15 of the first half. South Carolina, this is their sixth possession. Maddox for a short game. They've been in NC State territory 4 times.
Well, and you know what, though? I'm going to go back to this. NC State has a big break go their way, but Tom O'Brien showing that he's not going to panic, stuck with his game plan, and he went and put in Mike Glennon. So I think he realizes there's another half to go. He's trying to play with his strategy and his game plan. He's there. He's not panicking.
Tom O'Brien spent 9 years in the Marines. Panic is not really in his vocabulary. Third down and 3. Garcia, incomplete. Threw it into traffic. Intended for Mo Brown. And you would expect a punt here on fourth and three with a minute 33 to go in the half.
Steve Spurrier really play calling this game close to the vest. There have not been a lot of shots taken downfield. The game plan is to run the football and throw to the first down marker on third down and probably go run it again. Now let's find out what NC State can do with one more opportunity and two timeouts left. I'd expect Russell Wilson back on the field.
Spencer Lanning. High and short. And a fair catch made by Rashard Smith. And we check in again with Reese Davis.
All right, Sean, coming up at halftime, Mark May and Lou Holtz will join me. We'll tell you how the Sooners have lost a big-time target as Oklahoma gets set to take on BYU. Dr. Lou will make a house call, and he might be the second-best doctor. He's definitely the second-best golfer in his segment. And we'll look ahead to the chippiness that will be Oregon and Boise State tonight. It is all part of the Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff weekend, and we'll see you at halftime.
This is the Dr. Lou Bowl here. Lou Holtz coached both of these programs, South Carolina and NC State. Russell Wilson back in. He did not get out of bounds along the far sideline. Run down by Cliff Matthews. He's their big playmaker on that defensive front.
That is unbelievable speed from Cliff Matthews. Remember, Russell Wilson last year ran away from Miami's defense in that game. You're seeing the speed again demonstrate itself from these SEC defenses.
Under a minute to go, two timeouts for NC State. Wilson short throw. And that isn't going to do them much good. The catch was made by Jarvis Williams, the junior out of Orlando with 26 catches last year. And a timeout called by Tom O'Brien. Well, if he's frustrated, it doesn't show on his face. Tom O'Brien's expression doesn't change very often. But you look at his history, fellas. 10 years at Boston College. When he got there, he inherited that gambling scandal. The program was in disarray. 4-7 each of the first 2 years. And then it took off. 8 straight bowl games, all of which they won. You get the sense that the foundation's in place to do it again. But this is a stinker of an opening half.
Well, one of the foundations is the fact that they all believe in him now, first and foremost. And he had a locker room. Remember, Jesse, there was a lot of guys last year that really weren't quite sure if O'Brien and his method were what they were looking for.
I think the positive, though, on the flip side is South Carolina. His average starting field possession is their own 47-yard line, and they only have 7 points. That's the good news you take in at halftime. Tell your players to come and get a spark in the second half.
One of the things the NC State players talked about when we visited yesterday, they need to get off to a good start this year. The first 2 years under O'Brien, bad starts to the season. Last year they were 2-6, rallied for a bowl game. George Bryan, the tight end, with the catch. And he walked the tightrope to get the first down and get out of bounds at the 40.
Hey, you know, at this point here, 3 points would be great, but some execution like that right there, first down, something they haven't been doing.
Look, if you're NC State now, you're looking at around the 30-yard line. That's the goal. You got about 30 yards to go here till you get into field goal range. One timeout left. Work those sidelines. Give yourself a chance for a field goal.
This is the third first down for NC State. They do have a very good field goal kicker. Wilson, the pump fake, one-on-one battle, and it is incomplete. Off the fingertips of both players, but Jarvis Williams had the last crack at it, and he could not make the play.
That's like that dream that you have at night when the boogeyman's coming after you and you can't quite get away from him. Ball's right there. But at some point, State has to come up with a play like this. They have to get lucky.
I love the play call because Dana Bible trying to take advantage of a 5'10" corner in CC Whitlock versus Jarvis Williams, who's 6'4". That's a jump ball opportunity, and they took it right there.
And you saw Russell Wilson look off the defense trying to get that opening.
Now South Carolina wants a timeout with 39 seconds to go and 2nd and 10. The down and distance when play resumes. Each team with 1 timeout left here in the first half. This is an opening night doubleheader here on ESPN. Coming up next, Jeremiah Masoli leads Oregon into action in Boise against Boise State, and Kellen Moore, the Ducks on the road, trying to avenge the loss at home to Boise State last year. A lot of times, coaches like to downplay games. Chris Peterson said, the Boise State coach, it's like a bowl game the first game of the year. Chip Kelly, the new Oregon coach, making his head coaching debut tonight, said, it's the kind of game you dream about playing. So they're not trying to lower the hype.
I'm really interested in this football game to watch Boise State's defense defend the run. And they're really the unsung hero of that team last year until the Poinsettia Bowl, where they gave up 275 yards on the ground to TCU. LeGarrette Blount, 17 touchdowns last year. I want to see them stop him. I'm curious to see that.
Second and 10 for Russell Wilson and the Wolfpack, down 7-0. Look out behind, he is sacked. Never saw Eric Norwood coming. And Norwood dropped him for a loss of 9 back to the 31-yard line.
And again, Julian Williams is playing left tackle. He is the guard. Now remember, because of injuries, he's had to go to the outside. Slow out of his stance. Norwood's very fast, and the back not there to chip. They're trying to run away from Norwood, but to no avail.
There's no way Eric Norwood should get there when you position a left tackle and your running back to block him. Again, I've said it twice already, the speed is asserting itself. You're seeing the difference. South Carolina defensively playing much faster.
Neither team reached 100 yards of offense. NC State had 41 yards and South Carolina had 84. They combined for 125 yards. Here's Aaron.
John Banks, coach for Stephen Garcia. You said decision making was the key. How is he doing so far?
Well, we're struggling on offense. Fortunately, our defense playing very well right now. We had some opportunities, but we only got 7, so hopefully we can do a little bit better on offense. Our defense playing very well.
Your defense in without 3 guys that were suspended. How are they holding their own against this veteran offensive line?
Yeah, we got a good defensive bunch. They play fast, play hard. Eric Norwood's having a heck of a game. So, but we gotta do better on offense.
All right, Coach, thanks. Sean.
We're at the half. South Carolina leading 7-0. We'll join Reese, Mark, and Lou after a break. Seeing why I am, Tom O'Brien probably wondering why I am not scoring. That's the question that the NC State fans want answered here at the half. South Carolina leading 7-0. And the Gamecocks will kick off to begin the second half. Adam Yates drives it down to the 2 to TJ Graham. And he's out to the 15, and that's all. And let's take a look at tonight's Home Depot coaching adjustments, Craig.
Well, you know, this is really, when you talk about adjustments in this ballgame, NC State, their longest gain has been 7 yards. And it's 1.7 per snap. So, I mean, they're really doing poor. I think they got to go, Jesse, where they make sure they get away from Norwood, number 40, and get to the quick passing game to make sure that they can get the ball out of the hands of Russell Wilson.
NC State has to seal the edge. They need the quick passing game. They need to start using draws to slow that rush down and incorporate the screen game as well.
On first down, it's Tony Baker. His fumble on his first carry in 2 years on their second possession of the game was the biggest play of this game so far. He laid it on the ground at their own 14, and South Carolina punched it in about 6 minutes in.
I think Ellis Johnson told us that his defense was younger and less experienced, but more athletic and faster than a year ago. We saw that in the first half.
Second and 9, just 41 yards of offense in the first half for North Carolina State. That's one of their best-looking plays of the night, the completion of George Bryan, the tight end, chopped down by Alonzo Winfield about a yard shy of the first down.
And you know what? Nice job. Quick, get rid of the ball. Don't have to protect as long. A good little option route by his tight end.
George Bryan at tight end is a great story. He was forced into starting duty earlier last year because the 2 tight ends in front of him on the depth chart got injured. They found out that he might have the best hands on this team, and they're doing a nice job incorporating him in this offense.
Gain of 8. Now a big 3rd down and 1, and it's Russell Wilson on the keeper for a first down. And a moment ago, Aaron spoke with Tom O'Brien.
Sean, Tom O'Brien told me the biggest thing this team has to do in the second half, get a first down. They only had three in the first half. He said this has to change. Guys, a couple of injury updates for you. On NC State side, Jake Vermiglio, the left tackle, he is done for tonight with a left calf injury. And then for South Carolina on the defense, linebacker Rodney Polk, he's also out with a sprained right knee.
Tony Baker, the lone back. First and 10, North Carolina State. Three receivers. Russell Wilson, and he is sacked by Nathan Pepper, senior out of Greenville, South Carolina.
Well, let's look over here. Watch what happens here on the right side. Russell Wilson's got to find his tight end down the middle of the field. Linebacker level, let him have the football.
Nathan Pepper absolutely swam the left guard Andy Vardy on his way to the backfield. South Carolina defensive line establishing themselves minus two of their centerpieces up front.
Yeah, Clifton Gethers would be a starter at defensive end, and Lottie Adjaboy would be a starting defensive tackle. They're both suspended tonight. Kenny Davis, another important player in that defensive front, also suspended for this game. Good carry by Tony Baker. Now 23 years old in his senior year after missing 2 years due to injury. Antonio Allen made the tackle.
That's the burst that I didn't know that Tony Baker had. You see him get up in the hole, Jesse?
Well, that was the big question. The coaches this offseason had to see that burst in scrimmages. They felt they saw it, and that's why they were comfortable inserting him in the lineup here tonight.
We got the sack yardage back. It's still third down and 10. Wilson dumps it short, way short of the first down. No chance for Tony Baker to get near the marker as he was corralled at the 29.
South Carolina will live with that all night long. If they can keep NC State in third and long, they can go ahead, play big zones, keep everybody in front of you, and go make a tackle.
All right, so we talked about it, lack of execution. NC State, again, hurts themselves. If Wilson finds the tight end down the middle, where's this drive headed?
Jeff Ruiz had his first punt blocked. We've applauded, as we should, the play of the South Carolina defense, but it's still a game because of the NC State defense. A couple of times when put in poor field position, they've risen up to stop the Gamecocks. Auguste fielded it on the bounce, makes a couple men miss, and is finally wrestled down, taken down by the snapper Corey Tedder. They'll mark it at the 34-yard line. 43-yard punt and a 6-yard return. And we're back in the capital of North Carolina, Raleigh, home of NC State, trailing South Carolina 7-0. It could be a more one-sided score. A couple of self-inflicted wounds from the Gamecocks, an offensive pass interference penalty against Torrey Gurley, negated a would-be touchdown, and then problems on the snap and hold on a short field goal try cost them 3 points. It's just 7-0 as the Gamecocks go back on offense early in the third quarter, behind Steven Garcia leading 7-0. Play action fake, and Garcia's on target. First down and much more. To the NC State 36-yard line goes Wesley Saunders, the big tight end at 6'5", 280.
They had this play wide open earlier in the game. Steven Garcia missed him. They come back to it, and when you're running the ball effectively, Craig, those linebackers suck up, and that gives you a chance to make those plays over top.
That's blown coverage. There's no way that that safety did not have help on the inside. Tight end can't be that free down the middle.
30-yard gain. Garcia, another deep ball in a single coverage, and it's incomplete. Intended for Jason Barnes, and good coverage by Coyle George, a senior defensive back who came here as a walk-on wide receiver and only last year made the transition to play defense.
I think this is on Jason Barnes. You see how he starts outside and at the last second puts his foot in the ground and runs inside. When the quarterback sees you put your foot in the ground and begin outside, that's where he's going to throw the football. Jason Barnes just put his quarterback, Steven Garcia, in limbo on that play.
Barnes wasn't happy that he was demoted to second string wide receiver in the preseason, but Coach Spurrier said that Gurley has practiced better. DeMarco and Mike Archer will be irate about the shoddy tackling again. They had him behind the line, couldn't get him on the ground, and it's a gain of three.
Well, DeMarco is one of the captains of this football team. Being a fullback as a captain tells you a lot about his character, what he does. So you know he's a strong, hard-willed guy, but the poor tackling cost him 2 or 3 yards right there.
Third down and eight. It's play calling by committee this year for South Carolina, with Steve Spurrier having plenty of input, but his son Steve Jr., the primary caller to start the year from the press box. What does he have on third and eight? Garcia, first down. It's Gurley with the big catch at the 20-yard line. Gain of 14 on the completion of the redshirt freshman.
Steven Garcia, knowing he has cover two, and he's going to have his big target, Tony Gurley, sit down in that zone. Nice job again of Steven Garcia playing in rhythm and getting the ball out.
Did you see Rashard Smith, number two, try to get back in that passing lane? He's a true freshman. You know, just not getting there, not recognizing, but as he gets older, he'll realize he's got to take away that inside lane.
Well, the run successfully in the first half, relatively so, setting up these pass plays now. That's a little bit of a new wrinkle for Steve Spurrier, but that's not a new look. We've seen that over and over again over his 20 years now. This is 20th season as a college head coach, and of course the 2 years when he wandered away to the Washington Redskins. We're looking inside the beautiful Murphy Football Center in the end zone to our right. Certainly NC State has football facilities on par with any program in the country.
Excellent facilities.
They're down 7-0, 9 minutes to go, third quarter, first and 10, South Carolina driving again from the 20. Garcia across the line of scrimmage, hurdles a tackler, and goes out of bounds with a 7-yard gain at the 13-yard line.
That is an example of what Steve Spurrier does not want. Steven Garcia drops back. He's got a receiver wide open in the curl. You see Steven Garcia's eyes come down immediately. He tucks it and runs. And again, Greg, you know better than I do.
Well, when you leave the ground, yeah, a lot of bad things can happen. And we've seen now twice where Garcia's been protected in the pocket, but he abandons it, and he's not looking down the field.
Second and three. Straight ahead, the fullback, Patrick DeMarco, and another tough run by the team captain. Looks like they're going to mark him a little bit shy of that yellow line for the first down near the 10. It'll be third and less than a yard.
It looks to me as though the offensive line at South Carolina is getting a lot of surge in these tough run situations. If I had to define the running game right now in South Carolina, I would not say that it was a finesse game like it has been in the past. This is a very power-oriented run game.
With the new line coach, you can see his imprints all over. Eric Wolford. On third and one, a pass, and it is incomplete. And no flags down. They were looking for Wesley Saunders in the back of the end zone. He talked all week long about wanting to score a touchdown. He asked Steve Spurrier and admitted it publicly, if I score, can I get a celebration penalty? The coach said no, and that touched off some of the NC State defenders saying, well, you have to score first. It looks like they're going to go for it here on fourth down.
You know what? That's confidence in your defense. They know that NC State's struggling big time. Even if they don't get anything here, I'd kick it personally because I'd go two possessions.
Yep.
It's shown a lot of confidence in that offensive line also.
And DeMarco, second effort. And they're going to mark it on that yellow line. It was only with his effort that they got the first down. And I'm with you, Craig. They got it, but In a game like this, where points are so hard to come by, it's basically a chip shot field goal. Well, they did, of course, watch the snap and hold early.
Just a simple dive play right up the middle again. Patrick DeMarco.
That's right.
Fighting. How about Steven Garcia coming in, the quarterback, to get that extra push? A la Reggie Bush, yeah, pushing Matt Leinart in that game against Notre Dame a few years back.
Yeah, because DeMarco didn't get the first down initially. He was stopped, and it was the second and third effort that got the first down.
In the eye now with DeMarco in front of the freshman Jarvis Giles. Play action fake. Garcia in trouble. Threw it away. And that's an example of better decision making. Tom O'Brien out on the field. I think he wanted a grounding call.
I think Steven Garcia was able to get outside the tackle box on his throw, which is the only reason why that was not called intentional grounding. I like the decision to throw it away, but I'd like it to happen a little bit faster. You see, there's a lot of action around him here. First receiver not open, second receiver pump fake. Right now, throw it away.
And you know what I think is what's happening now is Mike Archer, defensive coordinator, is figuring out that pressure in the face of Garcia is working for him.
Into a quick count there, no room for the highly touted freshman Jarvis Giles, who rushed for over 100 yards in their spring game to get the attention of Gamecock fans.
To the credit of NC State's defense, when their back has been to the wall in this game so far, they've played brilliantly. The fact that South Carolina has only 7 points up to this point in the game really is a testament to how well Tom O'Brien's defense played when they're close to their goal.
One back and three receivers to the right, four receivers total now. On third and goal, a quick throw. They blew that play up with the pressure. Garcia forced to throw it away with Audie Cole right in his face.
Again, Mike Archer, the defensive coordinator, he's no dummy. He's been around a long time, and he's figured out that if we get pressure, get beyond the line of scrimmage, Garcia's going to throw the football away. Spurrier's hot because he knows he had a pretty good play on if he could have completed it.
He had a good play on, but that's a one-up to Mike Archer right there. Out thinking the old ball coach, setting up a blitz pressure package, taking all the answers away.
Now Lanning, earlier on a 31-yard try, they had trouble with the snap and hold. This is his first year as the place kicker, and he hooked it wide left. Suckup was one of the best kickers in the country last year for South Carolina, drafted by the Kansas City Chiefs. Lanning's new in the role and having a tough start so far. Anyway, welcome you back to ESPN's College Football Primetime presented by Applebee's. Let's take a look now at the weekend menu, also brought to you by Applebee's, and some appealing matchups. 3:30 Eastern Time Saturday on ABC, Georgia and Oklahoma State. 7 o'clock Saturday, BYU and Oklahoma on ESPN, and Alabama and Virginia Tech. 8 o'clock ABC Saturday night. Virginia Tech has struggled all time against teams in the top five. There's a late flag thrown as one of the best plays of the night for NC State. Might be coming back. Jamel Eugene taken down by Alonzo Winfield. Time of Virginia Tech, 1-24 all time against teams ranked in the top five. I was staggered when I read that stat today.
And I believe it's going to be 1-25 next time you read that stat.
Personal foul, face mask, number 64 offense. Half the distance to the goal for the spot of foul. Replay first down.
Well, Aaron Andrews told you about the loss of Jake Vermiglio. Andrew Wallace has had to see more playing time as a result, and he has hurt them a couple of times with big penalties.
Big penalties on big plays. We saw the big 38-yard completion earlier in the second quarter. Offense called for being downfield on the offensive line. Here's another big play. First play to start the drive. You got a first down. Now this is coming back because of a face mask.
All right, so I'm sitting here watching the game. And the strategy I'd look to is the tight end. Until South Carolina covers the tight end, I'm trying to find George Bryan, number 84. He's lined up over the top of your screen here. He's been running well, open. Get him the ball until South Carolina covers him up.
Five possessions in NC State territory for South Carolina, and yet just a 7-0 lead. More than midway through the third quarter now, forced to be conservative again. And the crowd understandably starting to get restless as Eugene is swung down by Devin Taylor. Here's Reese.
All right, Sean, on ESPNU right now, North Texas and Ball State opening up their seasons. Lance Dunbar, his second career rushing touchdown and first in almost a calendar year, putting the mean green on top, 7-0. And Stan Parrish's debut, it is now 10-0 at halftime. Paul Rhodes making his debut as head coach at Iowa State, and the Cyclones are up 14-0 on North Dakota State.
Opening day of the college football season. We're delighted to have you with us from Raleigh. There's finally some running room for Jamel Eugene. So it seems like we've waited a long time for the season. We have. This is the latest date to start the college football season since 1981. No wonder we were all chomping at the bit today.
It's been a long, long offseason, hasn't it? I feel like we've been talking about this forever. How long have we been talking about the Florida Gators and Oklahoma, Texas, Virginia Tech, Alabama, Boise State versus Oregon, all these great games.
We haven't told the NC State offense the season has begun. Wilson in the grasp of Devin Taylor's had a huge night tonight for South Carolina. Credited with the sack back at the 13-yard line.
My opinion, NC State's going to look at the film tomorrow. They're going to say, what in the world were we doing out there? It's like they're walking around in a fog. They talked all the big game and all the hype and all this and that, and they've come out and they look worse to me than they did last year.
Well, of course, the reputation, especially in this part of the country, the SEC is the football league, the ACC is the basketball league. And just watching this game tonight, there are two teams both expect to be in the middle of their conferences this year. South Carolina looks like they have the better athletes. Bigger, faster, stronger, generally. Augusti made the fair catch, and again, they're in NC State territory at the 47. The NASCAR Sprint Cup Series rolls on Sunday in Atlanta, presented by Pennzoil. Coverage begins on ESPN with NASCAR Countdown, presented by Degree V12 at 7 Eastern Time.
It is absolutely imperative right now for South Carolina getting the ball back in NC State territory. They have to make them pay with points.
We have one last car that wanted to
get out of the way.
Go through turn three while Jesse was talking. Here's Maddox straight ahead for South Carolina, and he gets a couple.
Let me ask you this, Craig. If you get another field goal opportunity, if you're Steve Spurrier, are you kicking it?
No, no, he will not. Well, we saw him go for it on fourth and inches. We thought he should have. He will not if he gets that. He's going for it.
Would you agree with what I said? The other football experts about looks like South Carolina has better athletes.
In pregame walking around, you know, the ACC bodies over on the right side weren't quite as big as those SEC bodies in the white jerseys.
Second and 8. Garcia's played mistake-free football till now. He threw it right into the hands of the defender. Michael Lemon, a backup defensive end. First turnover of the night and a huge one for the NC State defense.
Steven Garcia thought he had a 12-yard outthrow to the near side of the field, not anticipating Michael Lemon to come out of the three-point stance and play in the flat. You'll see Michael Lemon drop out from the defensive line. Just watch the eyes. There's not enough trajectory on that throw to get it over the big D lineman. And what hands from a defensive end to make that play.
267-pounder at 6'4". Let's see if that gives them a little life in their step. There was running room, and the ball was dropped by T.J. Graham.
We were talking about it earlier. It just seems like there's a lack of execution right now.
A focus.
From NC State offensively.
Focus is what I'm thinking. I think they want to, but it's almost like they're in a surreal moment out there. That NC State's players talk so much about this game and how good they have become that they've forgotten. And Tom O'Brien, you know, he had a lot bigger expectations for this game than he's seen.
He has to be very disappointed with the play of the offense. Wilson zips one. They want a flag. They're going to get a flag. Thrown against Darian Stewart. You saw the graphic. 0-4 in the league last year. Then they won their last four. A horrible start. And this is reminiscent of a year ago. They have too good a team to play this kind of football right out of the gate.
Pass interference, number 25, defense. 15 yards penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
This is the correct call. As a defensive back, you cannot run through the back of a defender to get to the football. If you come from the side, the ball's free and it's open, but you cannot run through the back of a receiver to make your way to the football. That's a good call by the referees.
This is the deepest penetration for NC State of the night, only their second time across midfield. Wilson after the fakes, a lot of time, nowhere to throw it. Finally threw it away in the general direction of Owen Spencer. It has to seem like he's watching a bad movie again for Tom O'Brien. They started out 1-5 in his first year here, finished strong, had a chance to get bowl eligible in their last game of the regular season, didn't do it. Then last year won their last four regular season games to make it to a bowl. They lost at the Papa John's Bowl to Rutgers.
As bad as they're playing right now, this is still a one possession game. This game is within reach if you're NC State.
And one play from even. Wilson out in the flat, running room after the catch for Spencer. He can fly, and South Carolina glad they banged him out of bounds near the 30-yard line. 15 yards on the completion of the junior from Leland, North Carolina.
And an outstanding job of coming back to the play. Dana Bible, they dropped it the last time they were in the bubble screen out here, and they get out with the wide receivers blocking for each other. Excellent job down the field. Jarvis Williams, T.J. Graham.
First catch of the night for Spencer, who had 31 to lead their team last year. Also had a bad case of the drops. Tom O'Brien joked they went to a hardware store and bought some hands in the summer. Under 3 minutes to go. Third quarter. NC State, Wilson. He can run two and runs for four when it looked like he might get sacked. Chased down by Shaq Wilson, a backup linebacker out of Jacksonville, Florida.
You see Ellis Johnson right there again, calling plays on defense for South Carolina. He's not going to sit back and allow these pass plays to happen anymore. Starts bringing pressure after Russell Wilson.
And there's an injured player on the field for for South Carolina. Fabian Robertson, the starting defensive tackle, in there tonight because Wadi Adjaboy, who would be their starting defensive tackle, is going to miss the first three games of the year for off-the-field issues.
You know, watching that last carry by Russell Wilson. Now, Jesse, we watched him last year. You've seen him before as well. He ran away from people last year. He's had now twice he's been caught from behind. I wonder if he's being cautious about his decision to run because he's had the concussions in the past.
Well, the coaches have told him this year they want him to do a better job of sliding, throwing the football away, or running out of bounds. And it's a delicate thing to tell a quarterback with the talent of Russell Wilson because you don't want to take away his aggressiveness and his willingness to run because that's part of his game that hurts you if you're a defense. It's a very fine line for a quarterback understanding when to go for it,
yeah.
And
well,
when to also throw
it. I know as a former running back, I ran with fear. I did not want to get hit. And you got to have that sense behind you that you're like, somebody is right there. I've got to go now and get after it.
Run like you're going to the bank.
I guess that's maybe better than running away from the bank.
Second and 15. A second and six, rather. 2:15 left as they snapped it in the third quarter. And again, he cannot run away. He lost the ball. Did Norwood get it before it went across the boundary? Yes! Cliff Matthews knocked it out. Another big play by the big playmaker in that front four.
And that is exactly what I was just talking about. These game-altering plays that Dana Bible and Tom O'Brien talked to Russell Wilson about. The play is dead. You're out of the pocket. Peripherally, you see Cliff Matthews bearing down on you. You're already outside the tackle box. Throw the football away.
Does he have? He did not have. Did he have control of that football before he got out of bounds?
Play is being reviewed. The crowd, as you could hear, saw the same replay you saw at home, and they didn't think Norwood had it until he went across the boundary. He's already at two sacks tonight, and if this stands, it'll be two sacks and a fumble recovery for the two-time first-team All-SEC linebacker.
It looks as though he kind of scoops
there's
it.
No way. Left
with his left hand, but you're right. That left foot looked like it's touching that white chalk.
I think this call is reversed.
regardless, I'm very, very impressed with the speed from Cliff Matthews we've seen today. That's the second time he's chased Russell Wilson down from the backside.
Okay, now remember this now. We've got Jake Vermiglio. He's gone from the left tackle. So you've got a left guard playing left tackle, even though he has some experience out there. On the outside, they are getting hammered at NC State. The speed of South Carolina's defense is just getting them.
And you can slow that down as a play caller. You can run draws. You can run screens. You got to get it out quick. You had talked about getting the tight end more involved in quick patterns. I like that idea right now because South Carolina is just faster coming off the edge. And they're able to get pressure with only four guys.
Yeah. Word from the sideline from Aaron Andrews. Travion Robertson left for the South Carolina defense with cramps. So that's good news. They'll get him hydrated and likely return. Steve Spurrier's body language would lead you to believe he thought that perhaps the ball was going to go back to NC State. Eric Norwood trying to save it. Remember the quote he said to us the other day? I wanted to go pro, but I needed to stay in school.
Well, he had only
the best thing for him.
He had only played linebacker 1 year. He was playing defensive end before. You look back, and he obviously saw the linebackers coming out last season, all those great players from USC. He knew it was probably in his best interest to come back one more year, get another year of experience under him, and then come out next year.
It's very important to Eric and his family as well that he be the first person in his family on either side to graduate from college. This is a young man who had a 1.8 GPA coming out of high school. Had to apply three times to South Carolina before he got in and has been on the dean's list many times as a GPA of 3.0.
The ruling is the defender did not have possession of the ball inbound. That thought is a fumble, thought it out of bounds. Return to the spot of the fumble. It'll be set down and 11 at the 31-yard line.
You know, Sean, to pay off your Norwood comment there, I think we all applaud the young man for his tenacity and his commitment to education. And he's always around the football. That's never been a problem for Aaron Norwood. He gets on TV and the guy gets around the football.
And Shane Beamer might have a second career as an official with the way he tried to help the guys in the stripes over there on that sideline. There are the numbers. With the two sacks tonight, he moved past John Abraham on the all-time sack list at South Carolina. Pretty good player. He'll have the sack record before he's all done at University of South Carolina. So it'll be third down and 11. They'll wind the clock under 2 minutes to go now. Third quarter, still NC State's ball at the South Carolina 31, down 7-0. And a new look with that bunch to the right. Wilson steps away from the rush, has a lot of running room, one man to beat, and he doesn't beat him. Darian Stewart is a very solid safety, senior from Huntsville, Alabama, with the play in the open field. They did get in a field goal range, and that's the option Tom O'Brien is going to choose here late in the third quarter. Get on the board.
Darian Stewart used to play that spur linebacker position in Ellis Johnson's defense. You see the open field tackling skills of a linebacker on that play. Russell Wilson would shake a lot of people out of their shoes there. Darian Stewart doing a nice job.
If I ask you coming into this game, if he's open field, one-on-one, open space, Russell Wilson or Darian Stewart, who would you take?
Russell Wilson all day.
Josh Chakowski to try the field goal. It's 42 yards. That was his longest last year, and he is right down the middle. Had a great year a year ago when he was 16 out of 19 in field goals, and that one could not have been more dead center with his first effort of this year. Junior out of Springfield, Virginia. So NC State will, at the very least, avoid being shut out by South Carolina for the second year in a row as we check out the headlines to open this season. Leading the way, Florida and Urban Meyer, Tim Tebow, going for that third national title in 4 years. The top three Heisman candidates, the quarterbacks, Bradford McCoy and Tebow, all return. Another big story, a lot of new coaches. Some of them have made a lot of noise already, including Lane Kiffin at Tennessee. Many of the newcomers are young. And what are some of the other things that you guys are looking at? I look at this first weekend of the season, and you see perhaps a different emphasis in scheduling in recent years. A lot of these big-time programs now more willing to take on each other.
It's either a great thing or a bad thing. It's great for the fans. We love these games. We love BYU playing Oklahoma, but it certainly is a hickey right from the beginning if Virginia Tech gets woodshedded by Alabama, for instance.
Lots of national title implication on the line here in the first week of this college football season. It's outstanding. These interconference games going on. Lots on the line as we kick off the 2009 regular season.
Including tonight, the second game of our doubleheader, Oregon at Boise State. If Boise State wins that match over the second year in a row, are they on their way to an undefeated season and a BCS bowl bid? Czerkowski kicks off. Down to Chris Culliver. Trying to turn the corner, and he won't. Rockdown. It's Rashard Smith again. Mike Archer was raving about that true freshman, and you can understand why. He's had a nice night. And here's a look at Boise State's schedule after tonight. And as you can see, it's not particularly tough. And there are those who have said already, even if they beat Oregon and go undefeated, they probably shouldn't go to a BCS bowl because of that schedule.
I agree. You know what? But it'll be there. We'll talk about it in November. And, you know, following up on your points about this game tonight, Jesse, with Oregon, Boise State's got to stop Oregon's big plays, the big strikes, the quick strikes.
Boise has not lost at home under Chris Peterson, 19-0 on the blue turf. Garcia has a man open and a first down out to the 34-yard line. Catch made by Torrey Gurley, 12 yards. C.J. Wilson had coverage.
I like that guy, don't you? I mean, Gurley's a big physical, give me the ball.
Not a Gurley man.
No.
In all the years Steve Spurrier was at Florida, I don't know if he ever had a 6'5" tall receiver. You're just not used to ever seeing that. He's got a couple of big guys on this roster, and they're using him tonight.
It's Sidney Rice at South Carolina, who was that tall basketball-type body. And they're on target again, this time to Wesley Saunders. Back-to-back passes for first downs. That's good for 11. It can be the last play of the quarter if the Gamecocks want it to be.
First two play calls on this series, both pass plays downfield. What happened to the running game?
Well, okay, and Mike Archer brought five the first play. South Carolina's offensive line picked it up. Completion. He dropped seven that time. No pressure. Completion.
We head to the fourth quarter. We listen to the strain to the one and only Kenny Chesney.
It's time to blow it.
ESPN College Football Primetime, BYU, Oklahoma, Saturday at 7 Eastern.
The most uncertain.
And welcome back to the season premiere of ESPN's College Football Primetime, presented by Applebee's. We head to the fourth quarter. Pitcher's duel tonight. South Carolina leading NC State 7-3 on a beautiful night with a temperature in the low 70s and low humidity. Sean McDonough, Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Aaron Andrews, delighted to have you with us. Garcia had to throw it quickly and fired over the head of Alshon Jeffrey, another highly touted freshman recruit, true freshman, out of St. Matthews, South Carolina.
South Carolina's up 7-0. NC State drives the ball down, kicks a field goal, and all of a sudden, I think you're seeing Steve Spurrier a little bit impatient all of a sudden. Yeah, running's great. Last three plays have all been pass plays. They're coming out firing.
Well, we've been talking about how well they've run it tonight, but they just have 59 yards. Well, it looks better than it has been because they've had so many struggles in recent years. And Garcia pressured again, got it off to Alshon Jeffrey. We talked to Mo Brown, one of their other receivers, and he said Alshon Jeffrey reminds him of Sidney Rice with that height and the ability to go after the ball like a basketball player.
He said he's got great body control. He can go up at high point at his top point. There's a lot of very talented true freshmen on the South Carolina team.
And you know what? I go back to what we all started this whole broadcast out with, was whether or not, you know, Steve Spurrier, South Carolina, this and that. They're playing with excitement tonight. He's coaching with excitement and passion tonight, answering those questions.
Big third and five from midfield. Garcia has time against a four-man rush. Trying to escape, gets it off, man open and complete over the head of the stumbling Mo Brown, who got twisted around. I think even if he stayed upright, it was going to be over his head.
Jesse, you know, as a quarterback, when you get a different look at the line of scrimmage, you're going to see a bunch of different bodies out here who drop into coverage, and he brings four. Look at this. Fire zone from the middle, nose tackle, right? It changes the eyes of the QB.
It was a fantastic of Steven Garcia getting out of trouble, but that's a throw he needs to make. He's got to relax. Bring that throw down. We've seen him miss a couple guys now when he's been on the run in pressure situations.
And Brown was wide open with room. The throw was far too long. Spencer Lanning handled a low snap and got it off. T.J. Graham, the fair catch at the 11. Here's Reese Davis.
John, as you know, every week we honor the AT&T All-America Player of the Week. Last year's Player of the Year was Texas Tech quarterback Graham Harrell, first guy to post back-to-back 5,000-yard passing seasons, 45 touchdowns in that Mike Leach offense. He was the AT&T All-America Player of the Year. This year, you can vote. Just text the player number 345-345 on your AT&T wireless phone. That casts your vote and also enters you for a chance to win a trip to the national championship game in Pasadena.
All right, Reese, thank you. First and 10, North Carolina State. Nice cutback and a quality run by Tony Baker. Tackled by Darian Stewart, but that's 9 yards on the run for the most prolific high school running back in the history of North Carolina. Over 10,000 yards rushing in his high school
career.
It's
great to see Tony Baker back in this game after being away from the sport for 2 years. Fumbles the first play of the game. He's had some big runs so far in the second half. And now with Jamel Eugene out with a sprained knee, the load falls on Tony Baker.
Wilson quickly out of the pocket to the right, and he is run down again from behind. It looked like he stumbled enough forward to get the first down as Devin Taylor grabbed him around the ankles. Here's tonight's Aflac trivia question.
Aflac!
Want to know who holds the NCAA record for most consecutive passes without an interception?
I know the answer.
Was it you?
It definitely was not me. You got to keep scrolling down before you get to me. But I think I know the answer.
You mentioned at the start of the night, Russell Wilson came into the year 249 in a row. He's now up to 266. And he has the first down at the 21-yard line.
I think Russell Wilson, when he goes back and watches this game and he really looks in the mirror, he's going to realize that he could play a little faster. He's just not the same runner that he was. I'm not saying he's scared. He's just being not the same guy.
Now, is that because they played against ACC defenses and they're playing an SEC defense tonight? Or is that just because he's playing slower?
Good question. Fair enough.
He did hurt his knee in the bowl game, but hasn't shown any real effects of that through the spring. What a tough run there by Tony Baker. As Dan Bible said, he's the kind of young man you root for. That serious knee injury. And when he was coming out of high school, he went to a high school All-American game where the other running backs among them were James Stewart and Rashard Mendenhall. He was in that caliber of recruiting class. In fact, Ellis Johnson, the defensive coordinator for South Carolina, said, I remember Tony Baker very well. Everybody recruited him. Everybody wanted him. But that's how long he's been around with the knee injuries. Those other guys I mentioned in their second year in the NFL. 12 and a half to go. Second and 6, NC State down by 4. Juggling catch made right along the yellow line by Stephen Howard. And it might require another measurement at the 31-yard line.
So now, you know, you think back, Jesse, we were talking about, you made the comment that Steve Spurrier, heck with this, I'm going to throw the ball. And he came out and he threw the ball and quickly put his defense back on the field because he wasn't patient and hit the ground running.
And I like how NC State offensively has just kind of kept plugging along. And these last two drives now, it seems as though they've been able to build a little bit of momentum. They're mixing it up nice.
Quick passes. Let them go. Get it out there. And they've been hurt by the outside defensive ends with
first
a pass
down
rush.
And they're about to break the century mark in total offense. 99 yards of offense now.
Well, they had 138 last year and a 34-0 loss. So, and we, Craig, you made the comment earlier. You thought they may have looked better last year than this year. A lot of football left to go here, and I like what we've seen the last two series. Kind of finding a rhythm finally, but it's taken a long time.
The feeling we'll see a little more offense on the blue turf from Boise when this game is over. Quick throw and catch. And it's Stephen Howard again. Sophomore from Charlotte. Out to the 38-yard line.
Athletic. That this is the baseball part of Russell Wilson that really comes into play for him with his feet, right? He kind of got messed up there, and all of a sudden, bang, he gets him around and makes a throw.
One thing Russell Wilson talked about was how baseball helps him as a quarterback in this sport, because you go through slumps as a hitter in baseball. He doesn't get down on himself. They haven't been overly productive so far this game, but here he is in the fourth quarter. He's still playing his butt off, and he's playing well.
Hands it off inside. Baker running on that rebuilt knee. Stopped about a yard and a half short of the first down. And Russell did go through a few slumps last season. He hit 236. Yeah. But Tom O'Brien said the baseball coach keeps telling me he has to have Russell because he's going to be a first-round pick. And yet I go to the games, Russell doesn't start some of the games. And he's hitting 236. But, of course, part of that was he hurt his knee in the football season last year and wasn't at 100%. He hit over 300 in a wood bat summer league this past summer.
All right, two down territory for you here. You want to give it back to him? You want to keep the ball? I know it's risky, but, do you go for it here? You got two downs?
If I don't get this, I'm punting because I think my defense is playing pretty well.
Just checking you out, Jesse. I'm trying to see if you're sharp early in the season.
And they don't have to worry about it as Wilson zip one to George Brian. You talk about the deliveries from baseball, too. Dana Bible said a couple times he's had to say to Russell Wilson at football practice, you're not trying to turn two here. Don't give me that three-quarters throw. Get back up over the top.
Watch his feet. Watch his feet. See those feet moving around?
Well, here's what Craig's talking about earlier also. Again, George Brian getting him involved. He does a nice job at tight end, working that boundary. Very natural, soft hands. He's been very effective tonight in that short-to-mediate passing game.
And now that line starting to open up some holes. It's James Washington, the true freshman out of Orlando, with his first career carry. And he has them across midfield by the nose of the football.
I'm watching South Carolina get pushed off the ball here recently. I'm wondering if they're getting a little bit worn down. We knew that they weren't very deep coming into this game. Right now, they seem like they're getting a little tired, pushed off the ball.
Washington, the freshman again. Bounced down at the 38-yard line. A couple of plays in a row with holes that have not been seen all night long. 12 more for the freshman Washington.
You know, Washington's got some speed and a burst. And this offensive line, look at him finding bodies here. The blocks beat your one man.
The center, Ted Larson, absolutely moved defensive tackle Nathan Pepper off the ball. It was unbelievable.
Crowd roaring. South Carolina, with its defense on its heels for the first time tonight, has called a timeout. We have great action for you all weekend long. Saturday night, ESPN brings you the Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic as reigning Heisman Trophy winner Sam Bradford and Oklahoma kick off their season in the brand new Dallas Cowboys Stadium. They'll host that dangerous BYU team ranked number 20. It's the Dick's Sporting Goods Cowboys Classic, a part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week on ESPN. Saturday, 7 Eastern time. This is the first game of the season on the ESPN family of networks. Defensive struggle all night. North Carolina State down by 4 on the move. 9.5 to go. And nothing doing there. A loss of a couple for James Washington. Sports Center right now with Reese Davis.
All right, Sean. Michael Vick has scored a touchdown tonight for the Eagles against the Jets. That's a preseason game. He'll be able to play for real in week 3 against the Chiefs, a game in Philadelphia. Roger Goodell making that announcement today after meeting with Michael Vick. And Jermaine Gresham will not play for Oklahoma against BYU on Saturday. Arguably the nation's best tight end, nearly 1,000 yards receiving last year, has cartilage problem in his knee. Next, SportsCenter on ESPN2 after U.S. Open tennis. Stay current, ESPN News.
Thank you, Reese. Loss of one on the previous play for NC State. Second and 11. Wilson's pass deflected and incomplete. Antonio Allen got his hands on it. Sophomore from Ocala, Florida, who has been in and out of the lineup over the first season plus. Ellis Johnson said he has as much physical ability as anybody I've ever coached, and he's been coaching for 36 years.
And the mental part of getting in that passing lane right there, that was a smart play.
The timeout by SC, I think, was very, very well used. They look fresher right now. They're running around a lot better right now. Monster third down right here.
Ellis Johnson and staff, perhaps an adjustment as NC State started to run the ball effectively. They go to the short pass here to George Bryan. And on third down and 11, they got four. And Tom O'Brien with a decision to make with 8.5 minutes to go and all of his timeouts. And it looks like they will punt.
You know him well, Sean. You know he's not much. He's going to play field position here, right?
I think that's the Tom O'Brien way, and it's worked pretty well for him.
It's interesting, you know, you're in no man's land right here. You're a little bit too far for a field goal. Now, you know, you're looking for a coffin corner punt here. The last thing you want to do is punt this thing in the end zone.
Well, it is great field position for a fake. Jeff Ruiz will kick it straight up in the air. And the fair catch made by Chris Culliver. They're going to spot it at the 14-yard line.
ESPN's College Football Primetime is presented by Applebee's. It's a whole new neighborhood. And in part by Bud Light, with just the right taste that never fills you up. The difference is drinkability.
A beautiful night in Raleigh, North Carolina. Season opening coverage of ESPN's College Football Primetime. And a tight one, a 4-point game under 8 minutes to go. South Carolina trying to protect the lead, starting first and 10 from its own 14. Steven Garcia with Jarvis Giles to his right. And they get back to the run with Garcia after a good fake. And he gets 9. Here's Reese.
All right, guys, the Utah Utes coming off an undefeated season last year, Sugar Bowl championship, taking on Utah State. The new quarterback, Terrence Kane, player of the year in junior college, will slant to David Reed, and he'll take it 65 yards. Now, the Aggies, coached by former Ute assistant Gary Anderson, just got a 96-yard touchdown run from Robert Turbin, is 14-10. Soon as we're done with South Carolina, NC State, Jeremiah Masoli's got the wings on his shoulders. He'll take the Ducks against the Broncos.
On second and one, big hole and a first down. And Jarvis Giles is still on his feet. The freshman of the 46-yard line. Finally taken down by Willie Young, a gain of 22.
I love the play calling here by South Carolina. Run the football, work the clock, fresh legs. Jarvis Giles, a true freshman, hasn't had that many carries here tonight, but you see the fresh legs pumping here late in the fourth quarter.
Every time NC State plays a base defense and they stay at home and just try to read and react, they get smothered. The only time they've been effective is when they're dialing it up, run blitz, or bringing somebody from the corner.
Good block on the last play by 76, Jarrell King, returning starter left tackle. Back-to-back runs of 9 and 22. And they're ready for Giles there. They were listening to Craig James. They weren't just going to sit there and play vanilla defense. Willie Young almost took the handoff. He was into the backfield so fast.
Really is a guy that has to show up right now and assert himself. He is the biggest playmaker on the defensive side of the ball. You're going to see him just work the A gap. He's so quick and explosive from a stand-up position. He gets great pad level coming out and explodes out of that stance to shoot in the backfield and make the play.
Loss of 5. It's NC State playing all season long without Nate Irving, their best defensive player, injured seriously in a summer car crash. Garcia over the middle. They'll have to gang tackle Wesley Saunders. It took half the team to get him down. The coaches love that effort by Saunders, who refused to go down. Finally, they got him on the ground.
Sean, they'll love that right up until about the fourth hit, and the ball comes out, and it's a fumble.
Mm-hmm.
The best thing Wesley Saunders did there was stay in bounds. It's allowing the clock to keep rolling here. Stay in bounds. He does a nice job fighting everybody off. Steven Garcia has to use this play clock and bleed it, melt it down.
Will Mike Archer dial it up and bring somebody on third and 12 or sit back and play soft?
I think you have to come after it in this instance. And they bring pressure up the middle. Garcia runs away from it. And he will be stopped short of the first down, just across midfield. And it'll be close enough now that if any other coach, you'd say it's a clear punt situation, but you could tell Steve's thinking about it.
Well, and you know, again, the dialing it up here, and you saw a lot of bodies coming, it disrupted the play. It forced Garcia to run.
Steven Garcia is not going to last the entire season for South Carolina if he doesn't start sliding. That might be the fifth or sixth time now he could have taken a blow-up shot. He's taking a lot of head-on-head collisions.
They will punt from the NC State 49 on fourth and four. Rashard Smith back along with T.J. Graham for the Spencer Lanning punt. Line drive and returnable. Caught on the run. Rashard Smith, the freshman. That might have been a face mask at midfield as he got collared. Tom O'Brien hollering at the officials. He thought there should have been a flag, and that's as agitated as he can be. Jason Swepson, the assistant coach there as well. Boy, from here, that looked like a face mask.
It looked like a face mask or a horse collar. It was a line drive punt, returnable. He's got him by the underneath the helmet. That is a face mask. That's a 15-yard foul.
How do you miss that? If you're an official out there and you're in the game and you see a body violently turn like that, there's no other way it can happen.
The ball should be on South Carolina's 35-yard line right now.
And we should note, in this game between teams from two separate conferences, these are Southeastern Conference officials on the field tonight. The Conference of South Carolina. Not making any suggestion on that, but people want to know, in a game between two separate conferences, where are the officials from? Baker, a 3-yard run.
The rule is, if you grab any piece of the helmet, chin strap underneath the helmet, or the face mask, that's a face mask. But that's a 15-yard penalty.
How do you miss that?
How did your logic? The brain says the body is flying down the field fast. It can't abruptly come to the sideline without having a helmet grab.
I don't know. We all know Tom O'Brien. Have you ever seen him that animated?
No.
Russell Wilson, last one deep. There's a flag in the secondary. A little solace for the fans. Stephon Gilmore, parade All-American, true freshman. And the coverage on Jarvis Williams.
Stephon Gilmore, who's had a very good game so far here today. You're going to see him get his hands, redirect him, and pull on the collar. That's an easy, easy call for the referee to make.
Second easiest call in the last minute or so.
Three plays.
Little pause here in the action. A little shout out to Chris Fowler, our buddy, who is with us a lot on Thursday nights.
Pass interference, number five, defense. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. First down.
But the umpire's bloodied.
You know, you've done an awesome job.
Well, those are big
Always
shoes to fill.
In the booth with you.
But we've been enjoying watching Chris on the tennis. I know he'll be back soon, but it's a treat to be here with you guys. And I look forward to watching you from the couch next Thursday night. You two actually like each other. I always thought you were faking it all these years.
We do a good job on camera, don't we?
Maryland always dreads me working with you for 16 weeks. We like each other too much.
First and 10. South Carolina 32 is the line of scrimmage. Down by 4 points in the final minutes. Russell Wilson lofts one in, a double coverage. Oh, it is dropped. It got through the two defenders and was dropped by Jay Smith.
That was such a roller coaster play from Russell Wilson stopping in the pocket to lobbing one up the middle of the field over two defenders. That ball has to be caught.
Okay, but I'm gonna defend Smith for a moment. Look at those arms and hands flying through there. I know you got to be focused. You got to catch the ball. I understand.
Concentration drill.
Focus.
And these receivers work on it all week long. The receiver coach throw them balls with guys and hands flailing. You got to come down with that.
Stewart and Gilmore went up a little early. Here the sigh of relief when Smith couldn't catch it. Now that one's too hot to handle for George Brian. Wilson looking for one of his receivers to help him make a play. That one was a laser beam through the hands of the tight end. And it'll be third down and 10. You wonder this late in the ball game, is a field goal even an issue here with three timeouts and 3:20-ish? If you don't get it, would you kick a field goal?
Go right here. I'd go for 5 or 6 yards and give myself the option of fourth down and short and going for it, controlling my own destiny.
I think three timeouts is nice. Greg, I think I'm siding with you on that, though. I think you need the points.
Wilson, a pump fake. Wilson's in trouble and sacked back at the 34-yard line by Cliff Matthews. Timeout. Tom O'Brien. And makes you wonder if he's going to think about going for it on 4th and 11. Sixth sack for the South Carolina Gamecock defense tonight. Time to answer tonight's AFLAC trivia question. Who holds the record most consecutive passes without interception? Andre Woodson. The correct answer, 325. Russell Wilson now up to 271, and this will be his biggest pass likely of the night. Fourth down and 11. They're going to go for it down by four with 3:11 to go from the South Carolina 33. Three wide receivers and the tight end Bryant to the left. Here comes the rush. Wilson rolls away, has time, throws it up for grabs, and it is incomplete, almost intercepted by Stephon Gilmore, who ripped it away from Jarvis Williams.
Wilson did what he had to do with his legs to buy time for a play down the field. South Carolina dialed it up. They came in, put pressure on Wilson to break the pocket and make a play for him.
Credit Ellis Johnson dialing the pressure up with Eric Norwood. He does a great job of at least just giving his wide receiver a chance. But what a play by the true freshman cornerback getting time today. And Stephon Gilmore going up against the bigger, taller Jarvis Williams and just wrestling the football away, the most critical point of the game.
Steve Spurrier says Gilmore has a chance to be one of the great players ever at South Carolina. He's done some nice things for them tonight. Now trying to kill the clock. Can they keep that running game going? Maddox out to the 37-yard line. And a quick timeout called by Tom O'Brien, leaving the Wolfpack with one with 2:57 to go.
You know, you look at the statistics of South Carolina and say they've got 96 yards rushing right now. We talked about how they wanted to come into this game this year and be committed to the run. We'll find out how good that running game is right now, because the teams that run the ball the best run it when they have to. And South Carolina has to right now.
Saturday night on ABC, it's two top 10 teams, powerhouses Alabama and Virginia Tech, colliding in the Chick-fil-A kickoff game presented by Southwest Airlines. The Chick-fil-A kickoff game is a part of Dick's Sporting Goods kickoff week, Saturday at 8 Eastern, 5 Pacific on ABC. That's another one of those SEC, ACC matchups like tonight, all time, head-to-head. For the SEC, 237 wins. For the ACC, 114 wins. So the SEC, historically, has dominated their neighbors here in the southeastern United States.
I think there's a lot of pressure on Virginia Tech in that game, because I think they're bringing the ACC banner with them into that contest. Remember Clemson going into that game last year? Got blown out.
Yeah, but Clemson was ranked high, you know, and there was, I think, a different expectation.
Well, Virginia Tech. Well, some people think Virginia Tech's the best team in the ACC.
I agree with that.
Second and six. Maddox. A short gain of two. Huge third down upcoming after we check in with Reese.
All right, Sean, I don't think we're going to get a defensive struggle in our nightcap tonight. Kellen Moore, the 2008 WAC Freshman of the Year, leading Boise State against Oregon. It's coming up just after the top of the hour, as soon as you guys finish with a slugfest down in North Carolina.
Can we go back to the Alabama game for a moment?
Yep.
I think Greg McElroy, I watched him through high school, great pedigree. I mean, the guy can play. He's smart. I think their offense, they're going to stretch. Julio Jones, we might really see a guy come on now.
That defense for Alabama is going to be serious again this year. Some people think it could be better than last year's unit. I talked to Brian Steinspring, the offensive coordinator at Virginia Tech, and he said watching these guys on tape, it's going to take all 11 guys offensively to have big games. It's not just about Tyrod Taylor playing well, but that offensive line is in for a real challenge, not just against Terrence Cody. That new 3-4 look in that front seven, they're going to be very, very hard to move.
Tyrod Taylor, he's got to match what McElroy does over there. He's got to throw the ball down the field. His receivers have to get in the game. They've got to have a chance to score touchdowns, not just completions.
This could be the play of the night right here. NC State with no timeouts left now in a virtual must-stop situation. Third and four, South Carolina with a four-point lead. They put it in the hands of Garcia. Will he make a good decision? Yes, he will. On the money, and what a catch by Mo Brown. First down all the way to the Wolfpack 28.
This play was simply designed to get Stephen Garcia away from the pressure and to throw this little hitch route you're going to see at the top of the screen. NC State takes it away. Stephen Garcia keeps his eyes downfield, and this time on the run, delivers an accurate ball, which he has not done all game long.
And you saw 19 Clem Johnson, the safety, go running across the field. Only three starts last year. The inexperience, knowing it, folding, rolling over with the play, covering up receivers down the field.
2:20 to go. You'd be very surprised if South Carolina throws another pass. Maddox for a yard. No timeouts left. And if you're a Gamecock fan, I know they haven't asked them to do much, but you could see what Steve Spurrier talked about the work in the offseason with Garcia. They really believe he's become a smarter, more mature, more reliable quarterback, a young man who's had a lot of problems on and off the field. Looks like a solid guy tonight.
Well, Sean, you had talked about his bowl game last year, and it was just horrendous football. Three interceptions, he fumbles the ball in the first half, and he really has matured. It's not necessarily showing up on the scoreboard tonight, but he's been careful with the football, and that's why South Carolina now is in the position they are.
They need him to be a good decision maker. They need to get a little bit of the running game going, and it hasn't been a tremendous performance on the ground, but it's been better and promising, and they play, according to some of the ranking systems, the toughest schedule in the country this year.
Well, you just look at some of these away games, and it starts at Georgia, at Alabama, Tennessee, Arkansas, and here's your home games right here, Ole Miss, you got Florida and Clemson. I mean, it's a tough schedule, so important South Carolina comes out the gate tonight with a win.
You know what maybe the highlight for South Carolina is? That the opening game, they went on the road to a full house with five new coaches and a quarterback and an offensive line they were trying to figure out. So to go on the road and to beat a good team, that's a big plus. That's a building block for Spurrier and his staff. Now they know how to work with each other within the 60 minutes of a football game.
Time for tonight's Wrangler five-star player of the game, and it's Eric Norwood, two sacks, eight tackles, 24 career sacks, the active leader now among SEC players, and second in school history when passed John Abraham on that list. And he has taken some of the responsibility as a team captain to rally this team together. Not only did they play horribly in the bowl game at the Outback against Iowa, but they were a team divided, a team that was very listless, to the point where Steve Spurrier admitted he thought about maybe it was time for him to leave after that game.
Fair enough question, though. I mean, you know, you've seen a man that's had such success in every phase of his life as a player and as a coach. You played underneath him. I thought tonight that was not a question for me. Watching Spurrier on the sideline, his intense against passion, new coaches around him. You know, they've had a lot of changes with his coaching staff over the years.
I'll tell you this, too. He talked about that great recruiting class they had last year and how a lot of these young players were going to play. You can see this is a special group. A lot of the guys we talked about tonight, Jarvis Giles at running back, Devontae Holloman at safety, Stephon Gilmore at corner, they've all made plays tonight and helped them win.
Third and eight. South Carolina used a timeout. Maddox, if he gets a first down, it's definitely over. He did not. Fourth down and one. They got to the 19-yard line. And on the other side, a big disappointment. NC State came into this game as a slight favorite with the feeling that they were building toward a big year. They still might have it, but they thought they had a great chance to win this game tonight.
I will say, you know, I was hard on NC State through the first three quarters. I thought that they came back and they showed some character. They did get a sense of urgency about them there for a few series.
They were very resilient here in the fourth quarter. You're right. And one thing we know of Tom O'Brien's teams, like we've seen the last couple years, they'll fight hard throughout the rest of the season. This is just the beginning. There's a long way to go, and that ACC is wide open.
Fourth down and one. Maddox doesn't get there, but it doesn't matter. The clock runs out. Steve Spurrier now 19-1 as a college head coach in season openers. The fourth time in the last 5 years they've opened on Thursday nights. Says players really like being the first ones out of the gate with the national audience. And they played a terrific defensive game on the road about 3.5 hours from their campus. They beat a team that went to a bowl game last year, NC State, and is expected to be even better this season. Eric Norwood in the defense leading the way. And Steven Garcia was steady. Didn't make the critical mistake. Made that one bad throw where he didn't recognize the defensive end dropping into coverage. A lot of quarterbacks would have done that.
Made the play on third, though, and long, right?
When the game was on the line and he needed to make a big play, he sure did that. He flashed his athleticism throughout this contest as well.
Here's Aaron Andrews with Steve Spurrier.
Sean, thanks, Coach. Going into halftime, you talked about your defense. Of course, at the end, Eric Norwood dialing up the pressure. But how about your freshman cornerback there, Stephon Gilmore, with that great play? What did you think of him?
Well, we got some good fortune when the ball sort of bounced off their guy at the end. But our defense was super. I just told Coach O'Brien this would be a good night to be a defensive coach. Unfortunately, I'm an offensive coach, but I still am very happy we won the game. Really proud of our defense. They played super. We sputtered offensively, but we did make a couple first downs here at the end of the game.
Well, because you are an offensive coach, I will ask you about your quarterback, Garcia, making a good decision at the end, but what did you think of his overall night?
Well, we got a lot of work to do on our offense. We're not very good right now. So if we got a chance against Georgia, we got to get better.
All right, Coach, thank you.
Well, the defense held NC State to 133 yards. We mentioned NC State had to be better on offense than a year ago at Columbia when they had 138 yards. They got some points this year, but they actually had fewer yards. With a veteran quarterback, veteran offensive line.
I think overall they're going to be disappointed. NC State expected to play better than they did tonight.
I think execution was very lacking in the first three quarters. They'll put the tape on and watch it and realize they missed big play opportunities that in the end killed them in this football game.
Gentlemen, I enjoyed it. Have fun with Chris
job,
the rest
man.
Of the year. Final score here tonight is South Carolina 7 and NC State 3. Great ball game on deck in just moments. Oregon and Boise State. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. Now for Craig James, Jesse Palmer, Aaron Andrews, and our great crew, Sean McDonough saying so long from Raleigh. Here's Reese Davis in our ESPN studio.
All right.